Okay, I'm going to talk about the development of the semantics test. This was a project of the ABLA lab at the UTexas. So when we started off working on the semantics test, not a lot was known about semantic development in bilingual children. So we started to think about what would be the relationship between semantics and primary language impairment. And some of the things that we know about vocabulary development in children are that children with PLI have weaker semantic representations than their typically developing peers, and they have less semantic depth. We also know that they require more exposures to learn new words. But we also know that if we give them a single word vocabulary test, that their vocabulary knowledge may fall sort of within the low normal range. If we think about what's going on with bilingual children, we know that they have normal language learning ability. They don't have any greater risk for language. There's no empirical reason to believe they have greater risk for language impairment than their monolingual peers. We also know that their experiences across their two languages are shared. So the concepts that they have are shared across their two languages. And what this means is that because their experiences related to those concepts come in two languages, they have divided input. So each of their experiences with their words will be less reinforced. They'll have less opportunities to hear and use those words. And so they may need more time to learn the phonotactics or to learn those words. However, again, if we give children a single word vocabulary test, we know that they'll score in the low normal range. So we knew that as we develop our semantics test, that we would need to develop an item set that was challenging enough to differentiate children with and without language impairment, but it wouldn't be dependent on the specific words that children knew in each of their languages. Because we know children are learning their different words at different times, they have different experiences, they're not necessarily all going to have the same vocabulary available in each of their languages. So we decided to take an approach of organizing our test items or our test blueprint around several core areas that tap semantic knowledge across the children's languages. And we drew this from the typically developing literature available for English language or English speakers at the time. So we had a number of different kinds of item types that we used. One type of item that we used that was actually pretty challenging would be analogies. So for example, an item such as hamburger is to plate, as soup is to bowl. We also use descriptions, so we would ask children to tell us things about an object that they might be familiar with. So something like, tell me three things about a school bus, or tell me three things about a truck. Category generation was another type of item that we used. So we had items such as, tell me as many zoo animals as you can think of. And we would give children a set amount of time to generate as many items as they could in that category. Another type of item that we used based on the developmental literature was similarities and differences. So for example, we showed children pictures of cards or invitations. And we would ask children to tell us what makes these kinds of things go together. They might be the same color or the same shape. Another type of item that we used was item functions. So we asked children to help us identify what we use different kinds of items for. What is this pencil for? What is a knife for? We used associations. So we asked children to tell me items that go with other categories. So for example, we'd say, tell me a word, tell me something that goes with bird. And we would expect the children to tell us that birds could fly. And finally, we tested linguistic concepts because that's an important school concept for children. And so children might be asked to identify the color or shape of something like a balloon or a box. So as we developed the actual items for the test, we focused on items that we thought would be challenging enough to separate children with typically developing and language impairment. So for example, instead of having single word items that children would have to just name or recognize, we had items that children might look at and might have to explain the difference to us for. So here are two piñatas. They're different. and we would tell us what's different about these two piñatas, and children would say something about the points, or they might tell us something about that there's a different number of points, or there's something different about them. Another thing that we looked at when we were trying to develop our items was the possibility of psychometric equivalence across the items in English and Spanish. So when you ask children to say to do the exact same thing as if you were directly translating a test, and you give children the same item in English as you do in Spanish, they may take that repetition of the item to indicate that they did something wrong the first time you asked and change their answer. It's not because they didn't know what it was that was different about the items or what you were asking, but they just take the repetition as an opportunity to say something different and maybe get it right this time and you'll stop asking them. So here, this is a characteristic property item where we were asking children to tell us about the features of these two items. And so, for example, in Spanish, we might ask the child, ¿Cómo es la pelota? What's the ball like? And they could talk about the color or the shape or the features. And in English, we would get at that same kind of item saying, what's his present like? And the child could, again, talk about the color, the shape, and the features. So we address these different kinds of items using different questions, but they were psychometrically equivalent in terms of their difficulty. And finally, we tried to develop items that required semantic knowledge, but that you could respond to using different kinds of vocabulary, in the same way as Aquiles was talking about with the pragmatics test, that there's lots of different kinds of appropriate responses that could get at the key feature that you were talking about, but could be answered in different ways. So here we're asking about how these presents are similar. And so children could talk about the red bows, they could talk about red ribbons, they could talk about red string, they could talk about the shape of the presents, but they would have to know, for example, that they're not the same size. As we scored these kinds of items, we provide sample responses that children might respond to in either language. One of the unique things about the semantics test is that we allow children to respond in either language. So in the English test, the most likely response is going to be the English response. But if the child responds in Spanish, we count that just the same as if they had responded in English, and they would get a 1 for either of those bolded responses to the first question, what makes these two gifts go together? We do also mark if children provide other language responses, just so that we can keep track of what language children are responding to the test in. So we started off with a very large set of items, I think about 187 per language. Took a couple of days at least to assess, to provide this item set to the children. Not the whole day, just a couple of test sessions. Although maybe the teachers felt like we were pulling these children out for the full day. And so we started off with an equal number of items in each of the categories. We tested these out with 71 children in our local school districts in Texas. We tested with 4-, 5-, and 6-year-old children, and we had a subset of 5-year-olds who either had nice typical language skills or definitely had language impairment. And so we used these iterative approaches to giving the test to identify groups of items that would reflect good items for the children. Items that reliably assessed that reliably elicited the targets that we were looking for, and that differentiated children with and without impairment. And what we can see is that as we progressed from our local set of kids to the larger set of children that we tested in different sites across the country, that the numbers of items go down because we're getting rid of the items that aren't so reliable or don't differentiate children. And we also see that over time, the numbers of items in each of the languages by category varies. So for example, we ended up with 24 items in Spanish and 24 items in English in our final version of the test. But you can see that, for example, we had many more similarities and differences items in English than we had in Spanish. But we had many more functions of objects type questions in Spanish than we did in English. So the overall difficulty of the test is the same, but the configuration of items varies related to each of the languages. in the final version of the test, what we end up with is that for 4, 5, and 6-year-olds, we see p-values increasing by age. So remember that p-values are the percentage of children who score, who get items correctly at each age. And so we see that there's systematic increases in Spanish and in English for the typically developing children who have normal language, as they increase from about 55% correct to 80% correct. And we also see that there's a progression for the language impaired children. So they go from about 26 to about 50% correct. We also took into account item discrimination. So that's the difference between how typically developing children and language impaired children score. And here we see that all of these items cluster around 0.3. And so that's an ideal difficulty level for differentiating children with and without language impairment. That's the target value. And we see that for both languages across ages, we were able to hit this through this iterative process of getting rid of items that don't work. The other thing that we see as we look at our semantics test is that it corresponds or correlates with related measures. So for example, we see moderate correlations, but highly significant correlations with language sample measures. We collected narrative samples on the children to whom we gave the semantics tests and the other tests. We see correlations in the 0.3 to 0.4 range. And we also looked at how our test correlated to the expressive one-word picture vocabulary test, which is a naming test, so looking at children's single-word vocabulary. And again, we see a moderate correlation there. But I think the other important thing to think about here is that we don't have correlations of 0.8 or 0.9. So our test isn't doing the exact same thing as these other measures do. So I think it speaks to the validity of the kinds of tasks that we're doing, but telling you that you're going to get different information from doing this than you would get from doing these other kinds of measures that you might routinely include in a large-scale assessment. We finalized our analysis by looking at whether or not we were doing a good job. What's our classification accuracy on this semantics test? We went and we used discriminant function analysis to set cut points to decide where was the ideal cut point to differentiate children with and without language impairment. And what we see is that we get very nice sensitivity and specificity in Spanish. We do see a little challenge there with the 5-year-olds, and I'll talk about that when I get all the way through this. We looked at the same thing in English. And again, we see sensitivity and specificity at all ages above 80%. One of the unique things that we did with the semantics test was, or we did with all of our tests, but we see here, is that, you know, children are bilingual, and we know that looking at the slides about the classification of how children do relative to their dominance, we know that sometimes children who are bilingual do better in their first language because they have strong word knowledge there, or we know that in typical development, children learn words before they learn grammar, and so maybe they're doing better in their second language before they're doing better in their first, they're doing better in their second language because that's starting to take over. And so you can use an approach where you look at children's best language to classify them. And we see that, generally speaking, classification values go up for the children. One thing that we see both in the Spanish and in the best language classification is that we're kind of right there just above 70 to 75% sensitivity. And we attribute this to some of the demands of increased use of English at kindergarten, putting a pressure both on their English and on their ability to retain Spanish. So that one's a little bit lower. Of course, the semantics test doesn't stand by itself. It stands in conjunction with the other subtests that we developed. And so you would need to combine it with morphosyntax to get really good classification of all of your children.